Not spending money on anybody, not spending one kobo on a single player is now beginning to come and bite Tottenham in the back. Take all of his mistakes, all of his mishaps, he will come up with something magical to help you win that flipping game. I was sure that they wouldn't make top four. I was sure. I had faith that they, based on just the damage that Uncle Mo had done, relax, don't insult Mourinho, okay, 2010. Based on the damage that Mourinho had done, that United would not get top four. And I always said that as good as Solskjaer had been with all of the matches won, this was their real test. This was the real test. And this was where you would begin to say, okay, maybe could this guy potentially be the real deal? The way in which United won this game, I feel gives even more weight to giving this job potentially to Solskjaer. Because if United had won like 3-0, 4-0, it was a complete revolution of Tottenham, then you'd be like, oh, is this some kind of luck or some kind of juju that they're using? But because it was a really hard-fought win, they really came under pressure in the second. They had to really dig deep. He had to make some key substitutions, and they had to show their mental strength to stay within the game against a very tough opponent at their backyard. Makes this such a big win and a huge win. We've got to address Levy. Levy has to be addressed. So when Levy looks at that, Sissoko goes off injured. First of all, you had a midfield of Sissoko and on wings based off injury. Now Dembele is going, Wanyama is injured. Sissoko now goes off injured. Eriksen now has to play back in midfield. We're not hearing that Kane limped off as well. When Levy sees that, how does he sleep at night? How does he sleep at night knowing that he did not give Pochettino a damn? Because, see, Levy has to understand something, that when you're running a football club, it's you have to have a balance. On one hand, it's a business. On one hand, you've got to try and win something. So the issue is Levy is running this solely as a business, where as long as we're in the green and net spend is all good, then it's all great. No, 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 no. The fans are too loyal. They've paid too much for you to be a pussycat in the transfer market. Tottenham are a one superstar signing away from winning the league. Two, three really good signings, four signings could take Tottenham to the next level. They are almost there, but you've got to spend. You've got to spend, because it is unrealistic to say, but you know, they're almost there, just try and just keep pushing them. No, 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 because it doesn't matter how much coaching Pochettino does. This team, as it's currently constructed, cannot compete with what City and Liverpool are doing. And what you see now is what I feared to begin with, because Tottenham were doing great, and I was like, man, how are these guys doing so well based on the fact they've not spent any money? So it surprised me. But that is now coming to bite them in the back. Not spending money on anybody, not spending one kobo on a single player is now beginning to come and bite Tottenham in the back. So that's why, you know, for Pochettino, he did the best he could, especially with what was a key injury from Sissoko. But for United, this was a really good 90 minutes per. This was a really good rounded per performance, because you saw how well this team can attack, you saw how well this team can defend, you saw how well this team can fight. And I think because the main elements about, oh, let me deal with Rashford. Let me look at Rashford first. I put Rashford in at tier 3. I think this was around the World Cup time and everything, because I thought, putting him at tier 3, I thought that, you know what, this guy can really do something and everything. Then I think under Mourinho and so forth, I was like, okay, this guy's trash. He's obviously not as good as I thought he was. And maybe I was wrong, so I think I probably put him under review or I inducted him in Class C of the Brick Academy. But under Solskjaer, new management and so forth, this is a serious player. He's a serious player. Like, there is a sharpness to him. And within the sharpness and so forth, and I know this will disappoint a lot of the racist, boneheaded, thick-headed white commentators out there, but Rashford is more than just power and pace. You know, the dude is actually just a good football player. A really good, talented football player with a lot of skill that can definitely improve. But I mean, beyond just his skill, his footballing ability, his intelligence, movements, this guy is improving his finishing. I think that is one area in which I thought, you know what, needs to be better, not going better one-on-ones. That finish he made was, let's see, that was a cold finish. That was a cold, cold finish. You know, because yes, he had time, but it was from an angle up against a top keeper. Takes alcohol, but still a top keeper. And he buried that like a cold hound dog. Buried that like a flipping cold hound dog. So just think, you know, I think Rashford has pretty much shown United and for Solskjaer that he can be that striker. Because I don't really feel United have like a main out-and-out striker. I just feel they have frontmen and they have an attack because they're so fluid. So they don't really have a target man. But I just feel as far as the striking dude, the guy who you're looking to get those goals, who knows? Because, you know, this is what I was saying when I was at UFF. I don't think Rashford can be the main striker that gives you 30 threes for United. But maybe he'll prove us all wrong. Maybe come next season and everything, he'll prove us all wrong and show that, no, I can't give you those 30 to 40, not those 25 to 30 G's needed because I cannot move on to that next level because I'm still young and I'm still growing and I'm still improving. Labille. See, what Labille did in this game is why is quintessential Labille. He had a bad game. He didn't have a good game. He lost the ball many times, didn't control the game, made bad decisions, made bad plays, you know, just was very bitty, very scattered. A few good things here and there, but there wasn't a consistent enough control of the game, especially with the responsibility of being the central midfielder. But despite that, he produced a key moment that helped United win the game. Because that, as good as the finish was, that was an outstanding pass. That was an outstanding cross-field pass. I mean, the vision, the skill, the technique to pretty much put that on a plate for Rashford. It's what Pogba can do. So Pogba can do like 1,000,000,000 bad things, but all he needs to do just, but he will come up with just that one crazy play. Just like as he did in the World Cup final, just come up with that one amazing play that can lead you to scoring a flipping goal. And that's why you always have to have him on the pitch. That take all of his mistakes, all of his mishaps, he will come up with something magical to help you win that flipping game. But I think this, despite that, for me, I felt that United's two best players, and I think the two best players in the game, were Lindelof and De Gea. Lindelof, I think, is showing why United bought him in the first place, and is showing the kind of form that we saw from Sweden, especially in the World Cup, and of course in that place into Italy, but especially in the World Cup. Because Lindelof, I mean, his blocking, his tackling, he was a big reason why Harry Kane didn't really have that much of a sniff. Obviously, he had more of a sniff during the second half, but I think for most of the game, for the whole of the first half and most of the second half, a big reason was Lindelof, just his positioning, general defending, general usage of the ball, right place, right time, reading of the game, sniffing out danger. I was like, my gosh, man, I was not seeing this on Uncle Mo. I wasn't seeing this kind of movement from Uncle Mo. Matic also had a very good game. The guy made some key blocks. And I just think that he formed a great defensive cover for the defense. I just think Matic's defensive work, his winning of loose balls, winning of 50-50s was huge. Even Herrera looked good. I mean, my God, that's crazy. Herrera, he actually looked good. De Gea. Now, people accuse me of being reactionary. You know, that's my gosh, you know, something happens and I just go crazy. It's not time for me to say to social media and the world out there that that's your reactionary. The best keeper in the world right now, currently based on form, is Ter Stegen. The grandfather and the daddy and the legacy king of goalkeepers is still Manuel, the Munich Wall, Neuer. Manuel Neuer is still the godfather of goalkeepers. But based on form, as of right now, it's Ter Stegen. If you watch anything beyond the Premier League, you will know why he's the best keeper in the world. De Gea, I would say, is top three. Easily top three. You know, so you could argue, you could probably say De Gea, Stegen, Neuer. You know, or you could say De Gea, Stegen, Oblak. But you have to now look at this. Some of the saves that De Gea made were pretty much, like I told you, I've been a keeper before. So I do know when keepers make great saves and when they make routine saves or saves that you expect them to make for someone of their level. Like the save he made against Dele Alli, you expect him to make that save, especially some a few of the other saves. But he made two outstanding saves. The save on Alderweireld and the save on Harry Kane, those are outstanding saves. Those are saves of where you look back and say, all right, boom, that's amazing. That's outstanding. That's clutch. But I think just to look at that and come back and say, remember, they are still playing Tottenham. They're not, this wasn't against a PSG, a Barcelona. This wasn't against like a Messi or a Neymar, a Cristiano or an Mbappe, you know. But you should look back and say, man, this guy is reiterating why he's one of the best keepers in the world. But to come out and say that he's the best keeper in the world, come on. You know, like you have to look at in detail the saves that he's making and the shots that were made for him to make those saves before you now properly critique Wagwan. Solskjaer, man. I mean, this is a big win. There's something up with mathematics. Remember when I said mathematics is overrated? It makes no sense that United are 6. These guys were like 11 points back a month ago. So how do you go from 11 to 6? Something's up with maths because that doesn't make any sense. So I don't know whether they cheated the system or anything. It makes no sense that they're now 6 points behind and from top 4. Chelsea have to be fearful. I'll be real. You know, I was talking to a dude on UFF who said that he feels confident that Chelsea will get top 4. That's insane. That is, if you're a Chelsea fan and you're confident and not worried about United, you're insane. Because I'm looking at this United team and somehow, someway, they are fitted into a system. Whereas I look at Chelsea, they're still struggling to a system. So, my God, there is a great chance for United to get top 4. But for Tottenham, is this where what I said in the summer comes true? How irresponsible can you be as a chairman or a club, or specifically a chairman, because it's about Levy, how irresponsible can you be when your team does so well? I think they finished like top 3 last season. Does so well. And the thanks you get is, oh, we're building a new stadium. The whole point of competing, which is the point that Pochettino was making in that press conference he had, was to compete in 2019. Forget about 1980 or 1998. To compete in 2019 to try and win a trophy, you've got to spend. You've got to continue to improve. You have to have a deep squad. You have to have guys who have to fight to be in the first team. For Tottenham, nobody has to really fight to be in the first team because the first team speaks for itself. Because nobody's competing against anybody. Because if you're competing against somebody who is hungry for your spot, it makes you better and forces you to play at a higher level. So we saw before, first half of the season was like, wow, maybe there is something of benefit of not buying anybody new. You keep that same chemistry and you build upon that chemistry because now you just saw that this team seems to have a greater rapport because they're all together and there's nobody new coming in to offset that. That was the first half. But now when I look into the second half of the season and what we may see is, okay, what happens when you get injuries? What happens when people become tired, become fatigued? What happens when people get suspended? What happens when people fall out of form? If that happens, you have to be able to look in the picture and say, all right, we still have this top quality guy we can bring. We have another top quality guy to bring. Harry Winks isn't ready to be a bona fide first team starter. He's a bench player. He's a decent player. He's not ready to be a first team dude. There has to be somebody ahead of a Harry Winks who starts this game against United. There has to be an alternative to a Dele Alli. Because again, this was one game in which Dele Alli just wasn't in there consistently. So Dele Alli has to be able to put his hands up, walk off the pitch because he's been replaced by somebody who is on his level, ready and hungry to do a better job than him. But you have a situation where if Harry Kane isn't on it or Dele Alli isn't on it, there's nothing you can do because there's nobody you can bring upon. So Tottenham are being pulled back because Tottenham, they are close to winning a trophy. They're close to winning a trophy. This team, as presently constructed, cannot win a trophy. They can't win. And I think they know they can't win. But they know that, man, if we just had two or three top players, we can do. And sometimes there's a saying, sometimes you have to take 2 steps back to move 5 steps forward. Levy, I'm sorry, you might have to take a bit of a loss. But by taking a bit of a loss, by spending that extra on a top player, on a real top player, You've scouted a real top player, top tier talent. You managed to attract him in here by the wages you offer and the transfer fee towards his club. He could take Tottenham to the next level. Because at the end of the day, you can coach all you want, have all the tactics, do all the positioning. A few individuals change things for you. Look at how Van Dijk has transformed Liverpool. Look at how De Bruyne transformed Man City. Look at how Hazard has grown to transform Chelsea. So look at what Pogba did for United. Those specific individuals can help you win games. I said again, if you put Gareth Bale in this team, if fully fits Gareth Bale, you put Gareth Bale in this team, they win the league. They either win the league or they come close to winning the league. That is how close Tottenham are to genuinely winning a trophy. But you need bodies, you need alternatives. And for Pochettino, he's like, look, bro, if you're not going to support me, and I'm looking around the world and I'm touted as one of the hottest coaching properties in the world, I bounce. So yeah, man, look, man, for overall, I thought it was a quality game, very entertaining game. And for United, man, these guys are coming. And as I'm looking at United, right, see, if United can get a Koulibaly, if they can get like a Koulibaly or a Skriniar, just a top defender, either is a Skriniar or a Koulibaly, February, I believe, 19th, against PSG, will be very interesting. Neymar, I'm watching you. Thanks for watching the video. Now think about becoming a Football Hot patron by pledging an amount each month and then gain access to exclusive content only on the Football Hot patron page. Peace. Head over to the official site at halffootballhot.com or just click over here.